So I woke up to a bunch of emails about how they're all snowed in Boston again, and they can't use the car park because they can't. It hasn't been, and they're sending me images, and I'm going back to that tonight. It's
can
just.
You get back? I'm gonna check.
Well, can I get?
Yeah, you think you're going back to that tonight?
God, it would be great if I couldn't. Will you check? Because
yeah.
If I can't get back, I don't have to. I would love to not get back to Boston.
Are you living or working?
I'm working. I live in London.
I kind of was guessing.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? Yes.
Well, I assume that they're shut. The production probably shut down if the airport shut down, no?
I think they're in the office. I've had emails from my art director. They're all in the office, but I think they had a bit of a hard time getting there.
Yeah. The challenges of Boston.
Yes, yes.
So is that part of the fun of what you do, is...
Working in different...
Places?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yes, absolutely it is. And I love that. I love that kind of craziness of my life where you literally don't know from one job to the next what world you'll be discovering in terms of production design and where it might take you. So it's two things. It's probably working somewhere you've never been before, but it's also discovering a world that you've never dug into before. And that's really good fun.
So do you have a specialty, or do you have a...
I have to admit, I love doing period. I do prefer that over contemporary. But if you ask me which period, any period. I just love that whole notion of recreating worlds that no longer exist. There's something that really fascinates me about that.
And the research is fun for you?
Yeah, I love it. I absolutely love it. And I do a ton of it. And that's the very sort of bottom base fundament of what I do. So I do an awful lot of research. I try to inform myself as much as I possibly can on the subject. And then the whole process of designing a film is that you edit. You use the bits you want to use and you don't use the bits you don't want to use. So you can use artistic license. I don't then slavishly adhere to the research. Sometimes I might actually say, this doesn't really matter. I'm going to ignore it, or I'm going to emphasize something else. But it's working from a position of having the knowledge. That's important to me.
Well, there are a ton of photos of Bletchley Park, so I
guess
that's easy.
Yes, actually, I have to say, Imitation Game, the research was very, very straight.
There were pictures?
Well, no, what's interesting is Bletchley Park exists as a museum, and they've got fantastic visual archives that they gave us full access to, very, very helpful. But because everything was destroyed at Bletchley, as you see depicted in the film with the giant bonfire, they recreated for their own archives all the different spaces after the war. Huh. So they took photographs that were staged, but within the spaces. So the spaces are real, but they just like got a bunch of extras to sit at desks. So instead of the pieces of paper that are on the desk, instead of them being actual messages that they're trying to decode, they're just random pieces of paper. So it's set up like
Disneyland, it sounds like.
Well, but they've done it, you know, it's all absolutely right. It's the right furniture, it's the right... So we had access to all that stuff, so it was very, very straightforward to do the research for that. And they have the Christopher, the bomb that you see in the film, they have a replica of Christopher, a working one, though, unlike ours, which just has to look as if it works. And that exists in their museum. And Morton, Tildum, and I went to see it on day one, and we made some decisions. So it was very important to create something that would be credible and believable, but we've sort of turned up the volume on its cinematic qualities. So we've made it slightly larger than the real thing. The real thing is completely encased in a box, and we sort of left some of the casing out, so you saw the innards and the interior workings of the machine, which are based on the reality. And the real machine does have red cables spilling out of it, but we certainly upped the volume of those. We, you know, took a little bit of artistic license there.
So how much does it work? Is it just
The rotors, really, the rotors move, yes, yes.
That's about
You're
it.
Not gonna crack any codes.
So is that, I mean, rebuilding that is, are you an expert in anything except for the visual at that point, or are you?
So only the visuals. And it's really interesting because I'm the least scientifically minded person on the planet. Luckily, I had a slightly more technically minded supervising art director, and I'd go, I like those bits, you know, not quite knowing what those bits are. And actually, likewise with the there are a lot of Turing's actual drawings and sketches and diagrams that exist. that we've dug out in our research, and we've replicated a lot of that stuff. And again, I'm looking at these things, I'm looking at them from a purely aesthetic point of view, but also trying to make sense of it all. And Andrew Hodges, who is the biographer of Alan Turing, very, very erudite, very academic piece of work. He came to visit us in the art department, and he was really, really excited by the research we were doing, because he saw that we were actually getting it right. And that validated my choices, which were much more aesthetic ones. But it's great when it kind of comes together. And the fact that, you know, it all made complete sense to him, I felt very vindicated in my choices, I guess.
So how does one become a production designer?
How does one become a production designer? There are lots of ways. People either come from a background which is either fine art, theatre, interior decoration, or architecture. And they come from those disciplines. Mm-hmm. And I can normally, you watch a film and you get, I can sort of sense if someone's come from an architectural background or from a theatre background. My training was in theatre, and I think my work has a slightly more theatrical bent to it than maybe somebody else's. Mm-hmm. I studied fine art at Oxford. Mm-hmm. The university does so many theatre productions, and I was doing the Edinburgh Festival every year, and Oxford Playhouse was a theatre that we got, you know, as a playground. It was amazing. And then I did a postgrad course in theatre design, and then I needed to earn some money, and I got a job. Actually, the day after I finished my course, I had a job at the BBC as a holiday relief assistant, which meant that you filled in for somebody who was on holiday, and they gave me a job, and I was there for 3 years, and then I decided to spring off and go freelance. But I have to say I've been a bit of a monomaniac about this job, and I decided I wanted to be a designer when I was about 8. So
what in God's name made you decide at 8?
Well, my dad was an art director, so that certainly helped.
And
I used to just be completely fascinated by you know, these worlds he used to create. I loved it, absolutely loved it.
But not as obsessive about the detail as about the kind of the overall image.
All of it. I'm obsessive about everything. I'm obsessive about everything. Yeah. But I still love it. I absolutely love it. And I think it's a fantastic job. It's a crazy job. There are much more sensible ways to earn a living, really, believe me. But at the same time, I think once you're hooked, people are either hooked or they're not. It's like it's like, I don't know if you know what Marmite is. It's that English, you know, you either love it or you hate it. Yes. And this job is a little bit like that. You're either going to be completely just sucked in by it, and then you do have to be a monomaniac and passionate and love it. Or I think you probably would go and do something far more sensible.
So did you enjoy the theatre? Did you enjoy life in the theatre?
I didn't actually do that, because I went into the BBC and then I got myself... I actually prefer, for me, the pace... I actually love the sort of the adrenaline you get from the pace you work on a film. You know, on a theatre, you're concentrating on, you know, for however long you're doing, you might have, you know, 3 scene changes or whatever it is on a stage. That's on a film, you have, Imitation Game had 80 odd set numbers. That means 80 individual spaces that you're actually filming in. Mm-hmm. So you're on this sort of, it's this crazy pace, and there's something kind of, I like that. I like the challenge of it, and I like that thing of it's like sort of getting onto a treadmill and you can't get off until the last day of the shoot.
So how did you first hook up with the movie? Did you get a call from Warden, or do you get a call from producer?
My agent rings up and says, no, what happens? The process is the agent rings up and says, these guys are interested. They want to send you a script. I then read a script. This is how it works generally, not just on this film.
Right.
And then, you know, whether the script appeals to me or not, then you take it to the next stage. Mm-hmm. And obviously, Morton will be talking to several designers.
Right. So what appeals when you read a script? What is it?
Oh,
that
the
you're
script.
Kind of
I'm really script driven. I'm really script driven. And it's about whether, I mean, this script is evidently well written. I mean, you know, and that. We all read a lot of scripts. And believe you me, you cannot say that of very many of them. I mean, there are a few that just jump out at you, and straight away you go, yes, interested. And others that you just kind of go, oof, why?
What is it you look, are you reading the setting? Are you reading the
overall story?
No, I'm reading the script.
Is it well written? Does it hook you? Is it, you know, and this one obviously is. And, of course, I'm also thinking about what I can do with it. what are my challenges? But before I do that, I've made mistakes in the past where I've thought, ah, oh, this would be fantastic sets to design. Pointless. If the script's bad, you're just wasting your time. So it's absolutely, I'm always script driven. And somebody said to me recently on an interview, it was actually, I think it was Empire in London, and they were saying to me, you seem to, how come you always work with really interesting directors on interesting projects? And you go, well, you know, you have to be selective. You do. And I got this script immediately. It just totally grabbed me. And I kind of got onto the agent straight away. Yep. Definitely want to talk to the director. Morton was in LA. Mm-hmm. I was in London. I had a you know, dark evening London Skype with sunny LA. And I'd seen Headhunters, and I, you know, his film had such a tremendous energy, completely different, couldn't be more different to The Imitation Game. Mm-hmm. But, you know, his energy and his storytelling, the way he just sort of motors the whole thing along, really appealed to me. And we had a Skype, and he actually offered me the job in the Skype. So that was lovely. That was, you know.
Do you know why, or is it just, besides the fact that you're obviously brilliant?
I think he liked, he told me he liked the work I did on Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy. You know, he didn't make any secrets of that. I think that's what got his interest in the first place. And, you know, it's all about, so much of it is about, it's about two things when you make that initial connection with the director. It's whether, I read a script and I immediately have pictures, visual images just immediately come to me, or maybe they don't. And if they don't, then it's not the right job to be doing. And so it's a question of whether, when you're talking to a director and I'm telling them about, you know, this is what I might do, and if they like it, if they like what they're hearing, plus if you feel you're going to get on. I mean, so much of it is about personality as well.
So when you go from a picture that is as well known and well seen as that to a picture like this, which is another big piece of British history, is there a fear of repeating? Or are you consciously avoiding?
I was very aware that there were certain overlaps, I have to admit. I was aware of that, because you're talking about, you know, mid-20th century Britain, absolutely, in a sort of slightly similar milieu, in that it's institutional. I was aware of it, yes. Yeah. And I think, for me, one of the most important things about my job, when people say, what's the greatest challenge? It's not building the machine. That's not the challenge. The challenge is to find an identity to the film, to give it its own character visually. That's, for me, the challenge.
And one of the things in this film that's very distinctive is color.
Yes.
There's definitely that red palette that shows up.
Yes.
I mean, is that a decision you make early on?
That came from the research. I would never impose a strong aesthetic notion like that onto a film unless the research, you do the research and that comes out at you. So, for example, you're looking at the stuff on the walls and you have the military, English military police with their red hats on their uniforms with the brown khaki and the red. You have the machine with all these rotors and the red wires spilling out of it. Turing's own schematics have a lot of red in them. And it became very, very obvious to me that that was a sort of... Also, I was very aware that we've seen World War II England depicted in film so many times. And it's always this slightly dreary, sludgy, brown world. And I thought, there's absolutely no reason for it to be that. And, you know, if you look at some of those Kodachrome early color photographs, there's a hell of a lot of color in there. And we did that. We looked at a lot of those, you know, early color pictures, and the colors really pop. Yes. And Sammy, the costume designer, you know, together, it's a very important thing that you, for me, that I and the costume designer can work together. Because, you know, what we both do has to evidently be compatible. So she also used quite strong punches of color, and not actually, we avoided, for example, all, if you look in the film, apart from in his early days in the school, all the wallpapers, for this period, there'd be loads of florals. There are no florals in this, not on the clothes, not on the walls. All the wallpapers are like a mathematical code. They're like Morse code. They're all geometric patterns. They're all dots and dashes. And that, you know, that is something which isn't obvious to anybody, but it certainly changes the tone or a mood overall. And if you're consistent about something like that, that's how you sort of give it its own identity, I guess.
It's one of the interesting things about being a film critic is part of the job is to recognize things like that, and part of the reality of any good movie is that you don't.
Exactly.
Know,
yeah.
Kind of like weird dichotomy in the work.
Yeah. It's true.
It too much.
It's absolutely true.
And here the Germans are coming over, but we'll take care of them soon.
It's true. And I'd say that one of the main, it's having an inbuilt sort of, you know, it's knowing when to stop. It's very important. You know, I do use color a lot in film. Wow. I use it a lot.
Yeah.
And I think I use it in a, as I said, you know, I have a theatrical background, so I'll use it possibly more boldly than somebody else might do.
Mm-hmm.
And you're right. It's the important thing is knowing, it's treading the line. It's knowing when to do it and when not to do it.
So you're generally, in terms of department heads, the first on, yes, production design?
Yeah. Yeah.
So is it interesting having a parade of people? I mean, Morden doesn't have that much history, so you're not getting the same family repeating over and over again, which some filmmakers have. Is it interesting to have people come aboard and to meld that?
Oh, yeah, and what, every single film, my relationship with the director will be completely different.
Mm.
Completely different. You know, in some cases, you have a director who gets incredibly involved with all the visual dialogue and what they want.
Mm-hmm.
You have other directors who are quite happy to let you go and do that stuff. And so that initial, you know, first few days, you're finding out where you are in that relationship.
So where are you in this relationship? Well, we had this one
with Morten.
Yeah.
It was easy, actually. It was very easy. We agreed about, sometimes I would come up with, there were a few moments where I came up with something which Morten kind of thought was a little bit on the strange side. I remember the huts at Bletchley, I painted this sort of rather repulsive shade of very shiny cack brown. When I presented him with that as a choice, he looked slightly shocked and then went, okay. but he was very generous. And we, you know, he set certain, God, what's going on out there?
It's sometimes the helicopters are looking for somebody.
He set various parameters. But then he gave me a lot of freedom within those parameters. So I'll give you an example. The second Christopher, the machine you see in Manchester in
right.
his house, that one we departed far more from the reality of the real thing, because Morten wanted, it was very important for him in terms of telling the story that it had a close resemblance to Christopher One. So, you know, he would say, I don't want you to replicate that machine. I want you to do something. And then, you know, we could go with it. But in terms of, you know, I'm kind of going, I want to use this crazy wallpaper on Turing's house. He sort of looked slightly askance at times, but was fantastic. He went, okay, go for it. I don't think we had any, I'm trying to remember, you know, you always think there's something where a director just says no.
Is that ever a good thing? Have you had that kind of creative conflict and have it be kind of pay off?
Oh, well, it's quite funny. I have to tell you, I did a film called The Invisible Woman, which was Ralph Fiennes directing and playing Charles Dickens. The Victorians, of course, went in for, it was an explosion of decoration, of wallpaper. So anyway, so there was a lot of stuff and Ralph took a while to kind of assimilate the whole thing, and I actually took him to the Victoria and Albert Museum where we wandered around the galleries, and I was saying, look, this is actually the reality. And then he rang me after he saw The Imitation Game, and he said, so you managed to bully him as well into your crazy world? He actually said, so you bullied the Norwegian as well.
Rafe is funnier than people realize, I think.
He's very funny.
Well, so you'll get to see Felicity.
Yes.
A few minutes.
Yes. Yes.
You're having your luncheon today.
Yes.
And you've had your luncheon before. Do you like this experience?
I haven't had a luncheon before.
You haven't had a luncheon before?
I've not had a luncheon before. No, this will be my first one. Oh, it's incredibly exciting. Of course it is.
Does it feel like you're being piped on board a vessel or a special? You're now part of this team, or is that? Have you been there for long enough
to remember?
Do you know,
it's incredibly, this nomination is really exciting. One of the things that I genuinely, and this sounds really cheesy, this was such a nice group of people I was working with, the producers are such good fun. I mean, actually, you can't say this about everyone by any means. I had dinner with two of them yesterday, and we just laughed together so much. It's a group of people I'm actually really happy to be seeing again, and really happy that collectively everyone has been recognized. I mean, how nice is that? You know, it's a bunch of people who you enjoy working with, you have fun with, and then everyone likes the work you've done. I mean, you know.
It feels like a theme of this year, actually, a little bit, because these films are all, there's so many kind of quirky little films and interesting little groups.
Yes.
They all seem, people seem to really have had a good time making each
of these films. Oh, I don't know about the other films.
Yeah,
but
yesterday we were with the Red Budapest people.
Oh, yeah.
They all, you know, kind of like a little cult.
Yes. Yes.
And the group from Theory, or, you know, everybody's kind of like likes each other. And very happy group this year.
I actually very, very briefly was introduced to Wes Anderson by Rafe, who I said to Wes Anderson, I've got a hitman out on Adam Stockhouse.
Well, not to be indelicate, but how long have you been designing?
How long have I been designing? My first movie was in 94.
So no wonder you want to kill Adam Stockhouse. Because he's been doing this like 6 or 7 years, and he's got 2 Oscar nominations already. You know.
No, I just actually particularly think, you know, Wes Anderson would be a great guy to work with.
So somebody who is, I mean, actually, it's interesting because we had the conversation, and everybody kind of assumes Wes is very, you know, he is very specific and very detailed, but also he seems to be more collaborative than people would assume, which is kind of this great thing.
Yeah,
about
no, him. I think it's so important to work with somebody. I mean, who wants to work with a didactic director? That's, you know. The best relationships are the collaborative ones, where you just have a constant dialogue and you push each other. That's what's really exciting, when you're working with someone who's actually, you go, what if, and they go, and what if, and you carry on and you sort of up the game. That's the best and most satisfying relationship.
So how much of your job happens after production starts on a show like this? How much of it is done before you
you're moving
roll?
All the time. We're rolling ahead of the shooting crew. So in the art department, you know, every this film, Imitation Game, 80-something set numbers. So I will see that Morton's happy on a new set always. So I'll be there first thing. But the minute he says, yes, it's all good, I'm off and I'm on to the next one. So you're just leapfrogging the shooting crew. You're always a step ahead of everybody else.
And are you tearing down your sets pretty quickly?
I personally, they come down immediately. You wait for Rush's clearance. Dailies, you call them, I mean, the minute I leave a set, very often, once the shooting crew arrive, Morton is happy. That's me gone. So I'm not there while they're shooting it or ripping it down. I'm already on to the next thing.
So, is there any ennui as a set that you love as you leave a set that you? There's no.
It's there on the film. Sometimes it's not there on the film. That's always a bit sad. Bunch of photographs, you know. You can't be. How could you possibly be sentimental about, you know? I mean, I get upset about the waste in this industry. That's a different subject altogether. But certainly don't get sentimental about the sets, no.
And do you check them in rushes? Do you go?
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah. Sure they... Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Have you ever had a situation where you've gone back because of the set?
No.
That would be on you, I guess.
You can't make a mistake. That's the crazy thing. And you know, you don't make it. It's very odd because we work at such, it makes it very difficult to sort of then clock into the normal world. You can't make a mistake. You can't have a bite. You know, if you look around a room like this, how many individual things there are, how many separate items, every one of those items has to have been thought about, put on a list, found, got to the right place at the right time, and you know, it's a big strategic thing as well. The crazy thing is you can't screw up. You can't, because you know, if you're doing a night shoot and the whole crew's there and some vital prop is missing, that's a lot of money and a lot of pressure. In the same way that, you know, you have to stay on budget. There's just certain, so it's not just all about aesthetics by any means. There's the stress, the things that keep me up at night are not the ideas. It's the, have I got this there? Have I thought about it? What might I have forgotten? How much is that going to cost? Is that going to take me over budget? That's where the stress comes from.
And I assume that becomes harder once you're in production, since the director is that much less available to have a chat.
Yeah, it's really interesting. It's very interesting because the relationship between me and the director up to the day one of the shoot is like this. You spend hours and hours and hours in a car looking at locations, talking. You know, they've normally got an office down the corridor, and there's so much interaction. And then on that first day of the shoot, the relationship is the director and his director of photography, and I'm sort of right out of it by then. And because they are so absorbed with the shooting day, in fact, when I appear on set with a plan or a drawing or something that they're going to shoot 3 days later, you can see them backing away. They don't want to you know, it's like, oh no, she's here wanting to talk about something in 2 days' time. And that's difficult, actually. And when I was working with Thomas Alfredson, his now wife, then fiance, was the assistant set decorator, and she was my secret weapon because I would give her a list of questions to take home. I didn't have to go up to him at all. And she came back every morning with all the answers. But sadly, that's the only time I've had that in my favor.
But another guy who seems like incredibly easygoing and...
Oh, he's fantastic. He's fantastic. Yeah. My Scandi directors. I love them. Yes.
Are you become the go-to girl for Scandi directors? Is that the... have a new thing.
Actually, do you know, I'm hoping to do Thomas's next film. So, you know, it's could become a thing.
I'm not sure he actually qualifies as a Scandi director anymore, though, I think.
Well, it's a what? What?
No, oh, Mr. Hollywood. No?
Oh, Morton, yeah.
Oh, Thomas and Morton, I guess.
Well, no, Thomas is still very much based in Stockholm, and yeah.
We like seeing him around. It's just a nice... It's always interesting, because everybody has this kind of... the directors are always very mysterious, or seem like they're mysterious, and almost like play to the mysterious nature of it, but then you spend time with them, and they're all... Some of them are... something else, but
yeah, oh god.
But many of them are very human. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, yeah. You kind of forget, yeah, that there's like a, yeah, just a normal...
No, I'm lucky. I think that, over there. You know, that's another thing, is that in the same way that you put far, far, far too much energy and yourself into every movie, that if the script isn't good, you know, it's like, why would you give it so much? And it's the same, I feel, I'm afraid, with directors as well. If you know, if you meet somebody and you click and you know you're going to have a rapport, if you know it's going to be torture, you know, it's for me, that's not it's very important to have that dialogue, to have an open relationship, not to have to be working with somebody who you have to be doffing your cap to, you know.
I think so. The last day of rushes comes at the end of the production, and you're clear, do you then relax, or is there more
you get
work?
Ill normally.
You collapse after, because you're allowed to,
yeah,
finally?
Yeah, yeah, there's always a period of, you know, some terrible cold or flu or something after a film, because literally the adrenaline plug has just come out, and it's normally a kind of physical and mental collapse. I'm not joking.
I know that feeling. And are you satisfied at that point? Have you had your pleasure out of having...
Yeah, but
work?
At that point you're so tired normally, or me, I'm speaking personally. Normally, yeah, by the end of the film I'm so tired I just literally you know, there's a sense of just the idea of being able to sleep in, you know, that's...
Sleeping in being 6 hours probably. As opposed to
I need
four
a lot of
three.
Sleep. I'm completely physically, you know, don't have the right makeup for this job, but anyway, my schedule this week is so crazy as well. I have I fly back to Boston tonight. I'm on a red eye. I go into a 3-day director's scout in the snow. Wow. And then I fly to London on Friday for the BAFTAs on the red eye again.
And are you looking forward to the BAFTAs? That seems to be the...
And I get to go home too.
The fun part.
I get two nights in my bed.
It's hard to be a celebrity.
With my all-suffering partner and the two cats. I'm very much looking forward... Of course I'm looking forward to the BAFTAs. Of course I am.
It's hard to be a celebrity. It's a lot of work.
Celebrity?
And is somebody dressing you for the Oscars? Have you been offered a dress, or...?
I've got my own dress sorted. I've got my... I had literally one weekend in Boston where I could go and have a look and get shopping, and I found something.
Okay. So, you know, but don't tell anybody, because, you know, they have to be able to ask you on the red carpet. That's part of the fun.
Oh, is it?
That's what they tell me. I don't...
I don't think anyone cares at all what I'm going to be wearing on the red carpet, but anyway.
You never know when somebody's going to ask. Somebody's going to think you're, you know... whomever. I don't know who they're going to think you are. Somebody as important as you are, and then they'll, you know.
Well, thank you.
He'll
thank
ask you what you dressed, what you wore.
Thank you very much.
And so when you're done with this whole, with the movie, the movie's locked, you see the movie, are you just done? You were saying before, you can't get really nostalgic, but
Well, actually, if, you know, because they were editing here on Imitation Game, I was really done with the movie. So apart from emailing, you know, like, Laura and Ida, we are always emailing each right. other, not about the movie, just silly nonsense most of the time. But because they were editing here, normally if they're editing in London, I'll pop in and see them during the editing process, you know, stick my nose in, right. look at how the, you know, CG stuff is, just have a little bit more continuity. But here, obviously, the distance meant that literally the last day of the shoot was the last day for me.
But I mean emotionally more than emotionally.
But the funny thing is, you cut off at that point, and then a year later, when the film comes out, that's when you reconnect with it. Hmm. So, you know, the fact that this film has had such a great response, and people have really liked it. And then, I mean, as cheesy as it sounds, it's so nice to see everyone again. It's so nice to be here and see all the guys. That is absolutely genuine, you know? So it's the double thing of having, you know, something that you've cared so passionately about for so many months, and then you've gone away. I have done another film in the meantime, so that became my, you know, everything that occupied. And then that's done, and then that will cut. So you're always leapfrogging from project to project.
Which you like.
Yes.
It's just it's a nice even. You maintain an even strain through all of that.
No, not at all even. No, it's obsessive compulsive and completely insane. It is. I don't know. Sometimes it is obsessive compulsive.
Could you do the job as well as you do?
I don't think you could. No, and I've noticed it's a character trait. Of all the people I like and respect, they've all got it. Because I think I need some help sometimes, and then I see that I'm not alone. That I think to do it and to do it with the drive that you need to have to do it, you have to. Everyone's got that drive. It's a driven thing, and you know I know I can see that I'm not alone in that. Far from it.
Yeah, movie's not for wimps. The movie business is not for
weak
people.
It's not actually. It's not. You're right.